podcast about authentic people doing beautiful things. Enjoy the show.
Welcome to the program, folks. There's a movie from 1998 called The Cruise. It's a documentary about a guy, I believe his name is Tim Levitch, and he's a New York City tour guide. He gives bus tours around New York City, and he narrates them as part of this company. And you got to check it out if you hadn't seen it. And one of the things that's fascinating about this film is this guy is obsessed with doing what he calls the perfect cruise. He gives these tour guides, and he does improv, and he knows all these things about old New York, and he just spins this phenomenal tale. It's unlike anything you've ever seen. But when he listens back to or thinks back over the cruise or that day's tours that he's given, there's always one mistake or two mistakes, one thing he didn't get right, and he goes, I just want to get it right once. Right, you know, all the way through this thing, and I keep messing it up. And that resonates with me so much when I listen back to this program. I've been so stoked for the past, really since the beginning, of the kinds of folks that come on and speak with us and the stories they share and the taking time from their lives to talk to us about their stories of transformation. And, you know, I'm a person who struggles with manifold insecurities, and we won't go into those here, but to say every once in a while I fixate on something when I'm listening back to a program. And last week, Dimitri Mujanis on the show, fascinating conversation, great interview, lovely, lovely human being. And when I was listening back to the program after we launched it last week, what I noticed is every time I mentioned his name, I would make a big deal of it. I would make a joke about it, a not funny joke. I would ask him if I said it right. At one point in the beginning, when I asked him how to say it, and he said Mujanis, I said, "Hey, Sean from Vice pronounced it wrong," and I tried to make a joke against the Vice guy. And the funny thing is, that dude's name is Shane. So all of that to say, that threw me into a 3-day spiral of depression, thinking I can't do this show. I don't know what I'm doing. Nobody's going to listen. I'm sort of kidding, but. You know, we hear the program, producer Mike's going to want to slit my throat for talking like this. Don't ever tell the audience how terrible you are. But we at the program are part of an evolving medium of podcast outreach and journalism here on the internet. And my struggle is for one of excellence. When I listen back to the show, which I guess for me is always part terrifying, but a kind of a therapy session as well. It's interesting to see that my particular insecurity for talking to a guy like Dimitri, whatever it was about his authenticity, whatever it was about his story, hit me in a way that made me feel trippy every time I pronounced his name. And I got stuck into this loop where every time I said it, I was like, is that right? What's going on? Your name's weird. How do you say it? Vaguely racist. Who the fuck knows what I was thinking? But beyond that, good episode last week, and we were stoked on having Amir. If you picked up on that kind of thing, spare me writing the emails about it. But if not, don't worry. I'll be right here to point out all of my foibles and missteps as a broadcaster to you folks as we go on together in this relationship. So this week, Reverend Billy Talen. I've been a fan of this guy for a long time. Reverend Billy, part of a New York City-based performance art group community, 50 performing members or so, the Stop Shopping Choir. Check them out on YouTube. Get over to their site. Get over to our site for links to all of their stuff. A wild anti-consumerist gospel activist, earth activist, who do all kinds of things like go to the Monsanto headquarters and perform exorcisms and preach out in front of the Disney store in New York City. just an amazing and committed group of folks. And what I love about what they do, beyond just being tireless activists for the earth, and interesting and talented performers, is that when you read their materials and when you watch them, you see that Reverend Billy is a guy that blends the lines, goes to those edges, and kind of steps back and forth between these two worlds. Very shamanic, very transformative stuff we're into on this program. And what I dig about what Billy's up to, what Billy's got going on, is that, and you see in their materials, their activism kind of bleeds into their performance and vice versa. And you never really are sure when one's stopping and the other one's beginning. I was talking to Douglas Rushkoff about talking to Reverend Billy, and Douglas said, yeah, you know, that guy's amazing because, you know, I don't know if you ever met him, but he's not kidding. Like, that's not a persona that he's got on. Like, he's really that guy. And when I spoke with Reverend Billy, it was, you know, I asked him about that, and it was a little more complicated than that, but it made me think of what Joseph Campbell and many others have pointed out, Jung, Freud, and a bunch of other patriarchs that we are all seeking to transcend the categories that they've imposed on us. But nonetheless, this Greek concept of persona, or the singular, or personae, multiple. What is an individual identity, and how does it relate to the collective, and how do we shape that, and how does that dialectic occur? And this Greek notion is, you know, in some cases, one is a persona. Achilles is the one thing. And the one thing only. And no matter what situation he's in, he can only be Achilles. And this is his greatest strength and his greatest weakness. Odysseus, personae. Odysseus can be many things. He can be a king. He can be a warrior. He can be a diplomat. He can be a faithful, loyal Greek. He can be a conniving, cheating, scheming scumbag. He can be a liar. He can be an athlete. Odysseus can do what the moment requires and can take on and put off many different masks depending on what the role is needed at the moment. And so the Greeks played with this notion of persona and personae. Who are we? Are we one thing and one thing only, or are we beings that take on and put off different masks at different times in our lives for different reasons? Do we have things put upon us that define us from without and limit our ability to express the deep truths from within? When I spoke with Reverend Billy, I was fascinated in this because, in a sense, he's not playing. This is not a character he does as a piece of performance art. I think it started that way, but just like this blending of activism and performance, I think the blending of persona and personae is very evident when you speak to Billy and when you hear him talk. He's an earth evangelist. Yes, this is a character he developed, I think, quite ingeniously over the past 20 years. But there's more to it than that. It's not simply a character. It's sort of a manifestation of a deep, deep yearning within the man himself. And so I can't wait for you to meet him and hear what he has to say. He's an earth evangelist. You know, he sounds and looks indistinguishable from the kind of 80s hyper-Jesused up televangelist that all of us remember, the Jim Bakers, the Swaggerts, and so forth. But he's an evangelist for the earth. He's an evangelist against our militarism and racism and consumerism and materialism that he believes, and I would agree with him, lie at the root of the wetico illness, the kind of psychic cannibalism that is eating away at the sanity of our collective space and the safety of it. What I love about Billy's work is that it seems to sort of coincide with some of the work that some other people that are friends of ours and friends of the show are doing. I'm thinking of Tina Fields at Naropa University. Dr. Tina Fields is one of the leaders, I think, in this country in the field of eco-psychology, which is using the principles of psychology to understand and give shape and some language to our human relationship to the earth and to the all the manifold species of the biota. I've said manifold twice in this episode. I think I used it right both times, but maybe I'm reaching and trying to sound intelligent for some reason. So note to self, don't make manifold the Mugianis of the Reverend Billy episode. So keep me honest on that, folks. Anyway, moving forward. one of the other things I dig about Tina's work is that it's developed into another field, which is related to eco-psychology, and that's terra psychology, right? So we can look at any relationship, any psychological relationship, as a relationship between two or more things. And so eco-psychology looks at our relationship to the earth through a psychological lens and focuses on the human side of things. Terra psychology looks at the same relationship, the relationship of humans with the earth, but looks at things from the standpoint of the earth, the psychology of the planet, in relationship to and many times opposition to human psychology and what that relationship looks like. Now, to do that, one has to intuit, assume, construct, or otherwise find a planetary mind that one can study through these terms, through these categories and mechanisms of terra psychology. Now, you know, go into the field, Google it, and check it out, and see the work that folks are doing there. But you know, from some physicists that we've spoken to and spoken about here on the program, to guys like Howard Bloom and others. And even with Ramez Nam a couple of weeks ago, Zach Leary, there's this conversation about planetary mind and whether you think about that as a metaphor or whether you think about that as an actual real thing, that the planet itself is a living organism and can be seen as having one big data processing, data sharing mind. We live in relationship to it and in relationship with it. And I think, as we spoke about with Dimitri and Dennis McKenna back in the day on Chris Ryan's show, this plant intelligence that so many of us are interested in, that we think might be the planet reaching out to us to try to communicate with us about the peril that we find ourselves in because of the fracture of our awareness and our tending to that relationship. I think Reverend Billy is a guy that's here to do the same thing. I think the planet has reached out through him in a particular way that we're used to hearing a message of transcendence, and that's through the monotheistic evangelist. And I think the voice that comes out is not kidding. I mean, Billy is very funny. He's very entertaining, all of that. But at the end of the day, what he's saying and the voice that's coming through him, I think, is very serious, is very transcendent, and is very rooted in whatever it is that this planet's unified data-sharing mind is, this planetary mind. So we were happy to have him on the show. We just thought he was kicking the pants. We only had him on for one segment. We caught him on a phone chat between a bunch of meetings. He's across the world now in Liverpool doing some stuff, and he's been arrested over 70 times, and so he was a hard guy to track down, and we had him on for one segment, not two, so it was a shorter interview than before. But we think you're going to enjoy it, and get a hold of him, get a hold of the Stop Shopping Choir, get onto their site and support them and the work that they're doing, because it's fabulous and important. All right, folks, thanks for being with us. We really appreciate it. Reverend Billy coming up, and we will see you on the other side.
live and die, no, not by the sword. I am weak without the joy of the Lord. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Let's bend our knees like we know we should. We can't see clear, no, eyes are made of wood. Taste and see, boy, that the Lord is good. He's my
United Nations. They tell us the globe is warming and it is human caused. Why can't we hear, see, touch, feel? The earth is not coming into our senses. Our heads are wrapped in some kind of consumer bubble wrap or something. We're not getting it. We're not hearing it. This wet, white and blue, spinning rock in space that is our home, is in grave danger. It's warming up. And if there's any change that's going to take place, it's a change that we bring about together. We must radically change our lives. Stop consuming the planet. Yes, stop shopping. What can we do? This fall, if you have a green dollar to give, do not give it to the big NGOs. There are good people in all sorts of institutions, but this year, I ask you, give to the volunteers on the ground who are risking arrest, putting their bodies in front of the bulldozers, the front gates of the coal-fired power plants, and going into the lobbies of the big banks, as we have done. It's for life. How do we say that to each other? Life, hallelujah. How do we get that basic? And remember that we're trying to save life. Life, hallelujah.
We don't have much time. It might be too late.
Children, we cannot negotiate with Monsanto. You can't do it. You might as well be arguing in the street corner with somebody about whether the earth was created in 6 or 7 days. Monsanto is a right-wing apocalyptic fundamentalist religion. All the big corporations, all the big nature-hating corporations are, and that's something that we have to understand. As Earth activists, we're dealing with a virulent psychological architecture that each of every one of us has. We landed on the shores here. We had the instruction: gouge, kill it, own it, get the money, find your promised land. You know, whatever that is, like some gated community in some like godforsaken suburb. Now, when we deal with Monsanto, we can't be polite. We can't be imitating corporate marketing. That is why, if you support the Church of Stop Shopping, you're supporting a legal fund. Because we know we're not just going to take a parking ticket kind of arrest. We know that we're going to be accused of something up to and including, perhaps, happened recently, terrorism. That's what a fundamentalist calls a sinner. You're going to go to hell forever. Burn in the lake of hellfire. Wah! All right, okay, all right. Where do we go? We go back to this thing that we slew, this thing that we killed. We go back. There are no logos on any of these leaves. We go back to the earth. The earth is our teacher. The earth will teach us how radical to be. And that's why we're here today. Amen. Back to nature. Is that did that become an embarrassing phrase for some reason? Amen. I'm joining up. You're my teacher. Here we go. Back. I'm going native. Back. Ah! Ah! Hallelujah! Ah!
We'll climb up the wall of Monsanto's office building in St. Louis. Carrying an amaranth plant, the fierce, highly evolved, delicious maize plant that will overcome Monsanto's fake corn. We'll leave it on the boardroom table. And then we'll leave.
Thank you for listening to On the Block. We talk to smart people so you don't have to.
All right, welcome to the program, folks. This is your host, Andy Gervich, and we are excited to have Reverend Billy Talen with us. Reverend Billy is a New York City-based activist, performer, and author who has spent the better part of the 21st century preaching on the evils of consumerism and the crisis of the earth. Reverend Billy developed his outrageous character preaching on the streets of Times Square and has since become an international activist figure. He and the Stop Shopping Choir, a radical performance community of singing New Yorkers, stage nonviolent creative actions around the world. Over the years, the Stop Shopping Choir has performed in the lobbies of countless banks, the United States Congress, the Christmas Parade at Disneyland, and Monsanto's corporate headquarters, as well as many popular theater, music, and festival spaces. They move fluidly between protest and art, curated by the likes of Occupy Wall Street, Punk Squatters, and the artist Laurie Anderson. Reverend Billy's message, which now includes a weekly radio show, stints opening for Neil Young on tour, and large-scale performances and community actions all over the world, is perfectly articulated on The Earth Wants You, a book and CD, which are the fourth official release from Reverend Billy and the Stop Shopping Choir. The 11 tracks on the record play like a joyful mission statement writ large, songs about climate change, revolution, empowerment, and community. Reformist hymns sung by a Saturday night subway car. Reverend Billy, welcome to the show.
Amen, Andy. Pleasure to be here. Praise be.
So let's start there. The end of your bio there, the reformist hymns sung on or by a Saturday night subway car. Tell us about that.
Well, the subway has been... I just got off the subway. The subway has been one of our churches. People sit there in a trance state. They sit there socially, talking to each other. Sometimes they sit there with their heads screwed into their favorite music or playing video games. But there's a way in which our singing and preaching is dedicated to breaking up the subway trains community, breaking up, getting people to raise their heads, asking them to, inviting them, I suppose, interrupting them, forcing them to come out of their trance state and engage in a way that public space, the parks and streets, well, I think I like to think that we had a more of a speaker's corner kind of culture. In the past, we've performed on Speaker's Corner in London,
London.
And we look for the Speaker's Corner wherever we are. Amen.
Amen. You tell a story in the book, and I saw you talk about this in Portland about taking your granddaughter, I believe it was, on the subway and reading her a Dr. Seuss tale. Can you share that with our audience?
Well, Andy, I appreciate your regard for my age. I am 66, and my daughter is 6.
Oh, look
so,
at me.
So the three of us, the three numbers
so sorry about that, Reverend.
Make us the double, of course. But
my apologies.
We had a very extensive subway relationship last year when her school was in Manhattan, and we lived then in Brooklyn, and it was about a 40-50 minute trip, and I read her many books, and we had a whole section of our day was devoted to traveling back and forth to this school. So this year it's only 20 minutes; it's considerably less. But yes, the performances in subways was ours, and performances by others was very much the subject of that one chapter in The Earth Wants You.
I'm fascinated by this, and the reason I'm asking you is because, and you've spoken about this before, and maybe you can tie this into a question regarding how the Stop Shopping Choir originated, but I'm a professor of religious studies and of mythology, and I speak with my classes about this regularly. We regularly begin the class with music because I inform the students that, you know, in all of human history, when people were coming into a collective space to create and sustain sacred space and transformative space, they almost always began with rhythmic drumming, with chanting, you know, whether we're talking about the Blue Stones,
yes,
and the monoliths, or as far back as you go, in almost every culture, music is that which brings people into the presence of the transformative and the divine.
Yes, exactly.
And then when you lay over it something that you've spoken about, the activist music of the 60s and 70s, and how it gave voice or chronicled the voice of those protest movements. If you lay that over it as well, music is not something for you and for your group that is just for entertainment. It's actually part and parcel of bringing people into that space. Would you say that?
Yes, sometimes a circle. We hold hands or dance and have, for instance, around a spraying truck that's spraying glyphosates, Monsanto's toxins in the local park. We'll hold hands around that spraying truck. sometimes the shape, making a circle inside a subway car, a little bit difficult, making a circle on a fire escape on the side of a building, a little bit difficult.
Wow.
Making a circle inside the Staten Island Ferry, very easy. So there are different shapes that we assume, but we have a high regard for drumming. We have a high regard for the circle. The history and prehistory of the circle is something we regard seriously, and it helps us become brave and one might say foolish. Foolaloo-yah. we have to risk arrest together, and we have to go into spaces of body and soul which are beyond right thinking. You know, we're not imprisoned in a Bill McKibben op-ed piece. We have to heighten what we're doing. It can't just be correct. I can't even if we agree completely with Reverend Bill McKibben, it must. We find that we must heighten what we're doing to combat the strong magic of New York City.
Mm.
You know, Starbucks and J.P. Morgan Chase and the places that we frequent.
I'm going to ask you about Bill McKibben actually in a minute here, but I want to ask you first, how did you start in activism? How and when did you hear the call to this particular ministry?
Well, I was not in a circle. I was on a stage with that proscenium arch and that edge of the stage.
Mm.
So I started in that shape.
Okay.
In the kind of on the performance art end of theater, shall we say.
Mm-hmm.
Which, when I started out in theater, that was pretty strong. That was a tradition that had some strength in the culture. And a kind of older brother figure was Spalding Gray. I always produced him in California, and then I would come back to New York and stay in his home.
Wow.
And he always encouraged me he says, that preaching character, you do that, But the person who who also befriended Spalding was an older man now passed away named Reverend Sidney Lanier, a lapsed Episcopal preacher who also had a fascination with the borderline between and the overlapping and the mixing of sacred theater and secular theater.
Mm.
And he started a famous theater here in New York called the American Place Theater with his friend Wynn Hanman. And Sidney came to one of my shows in California and took me out to lunch the next morning and he said, you're an interesting actor and I like your writing. But he said, there's a prophetic note in your voice.
Hmm.
And I said, well, what the hell does that mean? He said, there's a not that I know right now.
Yeah, yeah.
Not that I ever answered that question.
Yeah, but what did he say?
First of all, he gave me the impression that there was some kind of Christian imperative at work here.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, I told this man, Sidney, I was raised by Dutch Calvinists in Holland, Michigan. I want nothing to do with Christians. I'm an abused Christian. I'm going to spend the rest of my life in recovery. Don't even try.
Yeah.
You can go to Saturday Night Live or some other place with your preacher. You know, don't try to get me to be a preacher. And he said, no. He said, you don't understand. And he took me then on a 2-year tutorial and basically what he taught me is that Americans make their meaning through small moral adventures, Bible story size, tabloid size items, conversation friendly collisions of meaning and characters. He said that he told me that more than half of Hollywood movies to this day are the prodigal son story,
yeah.
some version of the prodigal son story. And so you see, he started taking me to Clint Eastwood movies, and he says that lots and lots of powerful American artists who have an impact in the culture know this about Americans. They know that Americans, they're not French philosophers. Americans make our meaning in a particular way.
Wow.
And he the souvenir, the more I looked into him, he really didn't tell me who he was.
Right.
But the more I looked into who he was, I discovered that he's Tennessee Williams' cousin and lived with Tennessee much of his life. They were friends as well as relatives. And that that Thomas Lanier Williams, the playwright, wrote a play, which became a movie, about Sidney Lanier called Night of the Iguana.
No kidding.
In which Richard Burton plays this lapsed, woman-loving, earth-loving creature. And do you know this
I do.
Play, this movie?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Oh my
the
God!
The opening scene where Richard Burton has a meltdown was not in the play at the beginning. John Huston moved it to the opening of the movie. That opening scene where he melts down and basically takes the umbrellas of the congregation and flails them in the air, and the congregation is driven by this mad creature out into the rain. And that is kind of that's the founding image of the Church of South Shotton.
Really?
We're in a place right now where we have to turn our institutions inside out. We have to drive our friends, our neighbors, out into the rain, back out into the earth. The bankruptcy, the moral inversions, the fatidity, the stupidity of our institutions is hurting us right now. We're certainly seeing this in Europe right now, in England. We've got to get back to the earth to re-nourish, to replenish, to find that seed inside ourselves again, and then start over. Institutions shouldn't be permanent. They do have a half-life decay. They should end at some point.
Yeah, the world is not the earth, my friend Ali used to say. And one of the things that's profound to me about your message when you say we are the earth and that the earth is speaking and speaking to us and speaking through us. And I remember when James Lovelock, came with the Gaia hypothesis, I thought, how far we've come that we have to have something called the Gaia hypothesis, that we're so alarmed at the possibility that the earth is a living, connected system.
Oh, yes, we can't take that. We can't. We resist it.
It's so completely obvious and flows through every part of ourselves, but for some reason we've been cut ourselves off from that knowledge.
When you see people as part of the earth speaking and thinking in a particular way, but when suddenly you have that hallucinating slip of the mind where you see all the people around you as manifestations of the earth, sometimes it just happens to me for a second.
Yeah.
I'll be walking down the street in New York here on 14th Street, and I'll see it that way for a second. And it'll just give me the goosebumps in this.
Are you ever able to see Manhattan in your mind's eye the way it was before all that metal and concrete got poured over the top of it?
Well, I'm Dutch, so I have my great-grandfather, William I, was here in the mid-1800s.
Wow.
And of course, the Dutch had already been here a couple centuries before that. So I have in my past the days of before the British took over. And
epigenetically, that's in you, that experience.
It is. It is. And my partner has old Irish, going back centuries, and late 1800s Jewish socialists in her blood. And so we both have a New York past, although she came here by way of New Mexico and Virginia, Charlottesville, Virginia, and I came here by way of South Dakota, Minnesota, and then I bounced off the West Coast.
Before I let you go to break, before we go to break, I'm not going to let you go to break. We're going to take the show to break. But
amen.
I want to ask you, thank you, sir. I want to ask you about, you mentioned Bill McKibben a second ago. And the show that we do, you know, I've had a kind of distanced relationship with Bill, and we don't badmouth anybody here, and I'm not concerned with being right in conversations. I just want us to get to a ground of connection and harmony and reestablishing our bonds of compassion and empathy with one another and with the earth. But a conversation that Bill and I had once stemmed out of an article I wrote called 50 Shades of Gaia, and it was my take on the climate change denial movement.
What a wonderful title.
Oh, thank you. You know, a friend of mine said, hey, if you want to get something, you know, with a little more notoriety, just glob onto something that's popular right now and steal the title. And I said, hey, that's a good idea. And sure enough, this got published in a British environmental journal called The Ecologist. And Bill McKibben read it, which was great. And he wrote me, which was great. And he said, I think you're being a little hard on monotheists. And I said, wow, okay, what do you mean by that? And in the article, I make the case around 7,000 years ago, and I'm not going to go too much into it here in our conversation, but something initiated in our species, and I talked to you about this before we started recording, which started moving us away from partnership models of not only of understanding our relationship to one another, but with the natural world, and into these hierarchical, pyramid-based ownership models. And, you know, the Epic of Gilgamesh talks about this move of the natural world, the cedars of Lebanon, going from being a sort of protected magical place to resources to build the kingdom. And what I said in the article was that unless we can, as a species, shift our consciousness back to an orientation of making nature our religion again, and not just the theater on which we act out our eternal ambitions, then we're not going to be able to make the necessary sacrifices to work together to turn the ship around. And I use things like the Gulf of Mexico. I said, you know, somebody draws a cartoon of the Prophet Muhammad, and Muslims go into the streets in the Netherlands furious and demanding blood. Somebody dumps hundreds of thousands of gallons of poison into the Gulf of Mexico, and we scream about it for a week or so and then go about our business. And what Bill said was, you're not going to get, you know, there's 3.5 billion monotheists on the planet, and you're not going to get them to walk away from their religion. You have to show them in their religion how they need to start loving the earth. And I see his point. My point back to him was, as long as we have these mythological systems that take nature and make it subservient to the wishes of men, we're lost. And I was just wondering if you can comment on that here before we go to break. In 3 minutes or less, sir.
In my book, The Earth Wants You.
Yes.
Bill McKibben, he's kind of a straw man a little bit, but I like him. And he's of course a very important figure.
Yes.
And I respect him. We talk on occasion, but his position, I'm in agreement with you, Andy. His position, he thinks it's realistic. It's the source of his, it's the assumption upon which he works, and he attracts people to him with the that basic architecture. His idea of common sense, his idea of what's right, is based on a kind of common sense, and he's very persuasive. Nobody can write an op-ed piece. He was the editor of Talk of the Town in the New Yorker for 20 years.
Yes.
Nobody can fashion a short piece that persuades faster and deeper than Bill McKibben. That being said, his writing indicates what it is by the predictability of the activism that results.
Mm.
He tried to bring lots and lots and lots of people to Washington, D.C. For symbolic arrests and gathering. He wanted to gather lots and lots of people. And he basically got folks there that were very much like each other. There was a kind of monoculture. Yeah. There were not enough of them. Not as many as Glenn Beck, the radio personality.
Yeah.
And a lot of them just, they were kind of approximately in the same age span. You could just kind of, the demographic was kind of clear. They drive Subarus. They listen to NPR. And, I'm describing my friends, and I'm not a young man right now. But
neither am I, by the way.
Magic, but I didn't think that the magic was there.
Yeah.
I thought that there was a way in which it was precluding the kind of move that a social movement really has. 360.org, his organization, ironically, they wouldn't say it's ironic, I would. Ironically, they use the language of social movements. Come build a social movement with us. But they ignore some of the essentials that historically have driven the energy of social movements. And I would say one of the things is the music, is the strangeness, is the incantation, is the flight, really 360.org. Its website seems like a program for a conference of the Methodist Church. It's very conservative.
Yes,
the graphics and what they say is good, and it's unimpeachable at every turn.
And one of the things about the choir,
that lots of social movements had somebody like Bill McKibben there, and he was a willing straw man. He knows what he is and he knows what he isn't. As a result of who he is, he attracts a great deal of money. Nobody's as well financed as Bill McKibben.
Yeah.
He's middle of the road, and he gathers a lot of people around him, and you need that NPR energy. You need those people.
That's true.
He brings in lots of people who are very educated. You know, I would say that he's very much in terms of what we're seeing right now in England. He would be remain in the European Union. You know, he probably likes Brussels.
He very much continues the Al Gore trajectory, right? In that sense,
exactly. He thinks that corporations. He never really says corporations have to stop.
Right.
He never really says those banks have to stop, and it's, you know, he's got some major hedge fund people giving him money, who's the source of those funds are you know, questionable, shall we say. Usually that's the thing about hedge funds, is you can't find where the money is.
Where the money's coming
from,
sure.
They're indexing and so forth. They're just kind of algorithmizing. So, yes, you see, he gives me a frame for saying what I'm saying.
Mm. A foil.
He gives me a frame for saying how I think we could improve or supplement what he's doing. And he's nothing but, he's a person who sums up the traditional NGO environmental approach of the big Sierra clubs.
Yeah.
One of the groups he works with. And we really have to move beyond the traditional environmental movement. Hasn't gone far enough. Hasn't gone deep enough.
And it's not moving fast enough.
Wiggled its ass enough. Hasn't you know, there's something more that must happen. With due respect, you know, those people have done very brave things, and boy, they are plotters. They have pursued these 6-year-long lawsuits. You know, they've done great work, and now we have to do more. Amen.
What I love, amen, man.
Hallelujah, somebody. somebody gave me an Earthaluya out there.
Earthaluya. We're going to go to break. And I just want to say this before we go to break. What I love about your work and what I love about the new book and the music is that it puts the ball back in our court as individuals. And it's not, I can't just write a check. I can't just vote for, a Green Party candidate and then go back to my life. I can't just write a check to a place like the Sierra Club. I have to start examining my own thoughts and feelings and behaviors and shopping patterns and where I put my money and my time and my energy and how I spend my life. And so I think that's something that's profound about the work. So,
amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, sir. Are you listening
on the other side?
See you on the other side, indeed. We are listening on the Block Radio, folks.
Gets me depressed, but what really gets me down is that damn convenience.
Hi, this is Zach Leary, host of the It's All Happening podcast, and you're listening to On the Block Radio.
Kids just got two more. What you gonna do when the temperature's cold? Now watch it. Welcome, children. I'm Reverend Billy from the Church of Stop Shopping. It is such a distraction here at the end of the world that there's such great sales everywhere, such wonderful discounts. Everywhere you look, a new Apple app, a new drowning Elmo, a new survivalist yoga technique. Sick of it! It's like the worse the disaster, the more valuable it is. We can download a marvelous 2-mile-wide tornado on pay-per-view and watch it just wipe out your own neighbors, like watching Lady Gaga doing the splits in a dress made of T-bone steaks. What is going on? An avalanche of lava comes into the little Johnson's front yard, and what do? They run outside. They go, let's grab a pic. Get the camera, honey. Oh, wow. Whoa, I got it. Whoa, that's amazing. What kind of reality shows will we have in the last minutes of American life? I just have to wonder. Are people going to go, oh, I hate that these coyotes and these cockroaches are pouring through my front door while I'm packing my things in my SUV to make my final drive desperately to higher ground. Children, what happened to my country, the United States of America? How could we be asleep at a time like this? How could we be walking around like zombies, consuming our own deaths, turning the apocalypse into products? How can this be? America was supposed to save the world. Well, all the movies, all the books, that's what we're doing. We got like handsome guys and gals running around saving the world for us. But I think we got mixed up between the virtual and the real. I think we got competing dreams here. We're lost. Finally, we get down to the point where we look around and we wonder, where did the consumers go? Where's my market? Where are my customers? The consumers consumed the consumers. The consumption of consumers by consumers has consumed the consumers. There's no consumer society because the consumers consume the consumers consuming the consumption. And the only people that survived are the people that got away. How do you get away? You get away. You stop watching. You stop buying. You stop shopping. Get away from this avalanche. Go out there and just join the animals. That's what I'm gonna do.
You've been listening to On the Block Radio with Andrew Gurevich. The show is produced in Portland, Oregon by Michael DiNapoli at MD Productions. Theme music by Moving the Mountain. Closing music by Jonathan Oak. Look us up on the web at ontheblockradio.com. You can also find us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Don't forget to tune in next week for a brand new episode. Previous episodes can be found on our website. Thanks for listening.
Oh, you beautiful kitty kitties. Oh, look at you out there. Beauty like a bolt of light in a darkened hallway. New minds looking at this world, at our lives, through the perspective of apocalypse children. Standing dusty in the barren highways, standing broken before the fathers who are meant to make us whole, but who only lied to us about what it meant to be a man, about what it meant to be a woman, about what it meant to be a child of this doomed age.